Hey, this is Tim Pierce. When Jon Bon Jovi was a very young man, before he put his band together, he did a master tracking session. And one of the songs from that session ended up being, I think, his first single. It's called Runaway. And I played the guitars on Runaway. I used to walk into Trader Joe's and hear it all the time. Steve Stine and I do split screen teleconferencing. And Steve was saying, hey, can I interview you about Runaway? I want to know how it went down. So that's part two of this. Part one, I give you a breakdown of the solo. Click the link below. If you want to check out the masterclass, we're up to over 100 hours of lessons and content. And then what follows is a look at the solo done a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. Here are the chords, A minor C D, A minor C G, then that cycle repeats and then it lands on an E. So I start the solo with unison bends. And then A minor pentatonic. And then when the band goes to D, I follow them. See the D chord right there? And I do the minor major hammer-on. When it goes back to A minor, I do a repetitive phrase. Kind of nice to do repetition sometimes, and it's just three octaves. Covering the next A minor. Now the next move is all chordal, because the band's going from C to G, and I come up here, and I'm basically seeing the G chord there and the C chord there. So I slide up. And that corresponds, that C note corresponds to when the band goes to C. And then the band goes to G and I follow also. Double stops with lots of distortions. Seeing that G chord. And I slide up. That gives me a chance to kind of figure out what I'm doing. A lot of the times in the past when I would slide up, my mind was going, okay, where am I going to land? Am I going to land here? Am I going to land here? Or literally, as I'm sliding up, I'm going, okay, where am I going to land? And I slide up and I see the G chord there and I go, that's safe. So that's kind of really following the chords. And then I come up, A minor pentatonic, just for thickness, this double stop. Let's hear the actual riff. Yeah. Little finger planted here, third finger pulling, and lots of vibrato. And then next, I do some sliding. I've always loved Steve Lukather, and I loved him back then. And I heard a solo that he did where he did some downward slide. And I thought, that's the coolest thing since. So I started doing slides in my solos. And what this is a slide up and a slide down. So when I start this lick out, I am visualizing chords. The A minor, then the C again, the A minor again. So A minor here, C here, and then A minor here. Two notes, a slide up and a slide down. Then as I continue up, it becomes A minor pentatonic. Just on the top two strings, kind of up the scale, do it slow. So I'm walking up on the B string and on the E string. So I picked up the isolated track here from YouTube and I've got it plugged into my rep pedal and I have it looped at half speed. Thank you. So I'm putting in a little bit of melody. It's the ninth. Other than that, it's just pentatonic. And I did enjoy kind of, and I still do, I enjoy ending solos on a low note rather than a high note. And that's what this is. A pretty darn wide vibrato at the end.
So Tim, I got to ask you about this whole Bon Jovi Runaway thing. I've known for a long time that you played on it, but I was in the car with my daughter. She's 10 years old and the radio was on and Runaway came on and I was trying to explain to her that it was you that played on that tune. And she, of course, didn't really care because she doesn't care about Bon Jovi or any of the music I listen to anyway. But I thought it would be a really amazing story because I don't know the story. All I know is from the general perspective that Bon Jovi wasn't really Bon Jovi at this point. It was just Jon Bon Jovi. And so if you would give us the story, I would love to hear it.
Yeah, I'll run it down quickly. I was hired to do a John Waite record in Manhattan, and Neil Giraldo was the producer, which at the time was very exciting because he was the other half of Pat Benatar, a great guitar player. They were doing great records. And so I went to New York, and the record was at the Power Station, which was owned by Tony Bon Jovi. And John was living upstairs. It's a story that's pretty famous. He was living upstairs and sweeping the floors and learning whatever he could about recording. It was an apartment up above. So we did this John Waite record, and the guitars were going well. And John, you know, I met John, and he said, "Hey, I'm going to do some master demos. Why don't you come back? You know, when you come back to New York, why don't you come do them with me?" I said, of course I'll do them. So we tracked all the stuff. And then when it came time to do Runaway, I started overdubbing. And for whatever reason, I ended up doing all the rhythms and all the leads on that song. We plugged into different Marshalls. And I had my Schecter Stratocaster that had a gold pickguard. And I also think I had a BC Rich. And they just brought all the Marshalls. And we did all that stuff. So a little later on, John played me the actual, you know, finished demos. And I think we went to dinner at his mom's house and it sounded great, but I was already in Rick Springfield's band at that point. And Rick was arguably one of the biggest stars in America at that point. And it was a really fun thing. And I didn't really have the image to be in Bon Jovi anyway. And he eventually got his mates, including Richie Sambora, who was absolutely the right guitar player for him, to be in the band with him. But the coolest thing for me was there was one song that ended up on the first Bon Jovi record that wasn't the band. And it was that song Runaway. And, and we were all credited. If you look at the LP, we're all credited, or the CD or Wikipedia, wherever you look. I mean, so he was good about that. and the funny thing was, I remember touring with Rick Springfield and watching Bon Jovi in front of my very eyes become the biggest rock band in the world. Right. And I was kind of like, well, wait a second. I was right next to that. What did I, is that a train? Was there a train that I was supposed to walk onto that a train in the train station that I was, could have just stepped on?
Yeah, right. That's just amazing. So when it was just a chance meeting.
So I was there at the Power Station, and Neil Giraldo, if you listen to the guitars on Ignition by John Waite, they're great guitars. And it's because Neil Giraldo basically held me, you know, he taught me how to get sounds. It was an awesome thing for me. And so we were doing great guitars. He heard those guitars and he asked me to do his music.
Because had John done something prior to this?
Okay, I'm glad you asked that. Okay, I think he was 18 years old. I was 23 and he was 18. At 18, he had laser focus. He knew exactly what he wanted to do. And then because in those days, you had to have a studio. You had to have all the best stuff. You couldn't do it yourself. You had to you had to have a patron. And he had a patron. He had Tony. So he had everything in place. So he took those demos to a record company. They signed him. And then the really smart thing, I think, the thing that catapulted them, so he got the record deal. He put his band together. He didn't get sidetracked. He knew exactly what he wanted to do. So I saw that. I mean, and that's rare. And also, so there was a music industry ready for him at that point. Because if you knew people and you had a good master demo, you could get signed. You know, I'm sure he got a good attorney and Tony hooked him up or whatever. However it worked, that's another story that I don't know.
Sure.
But the thing that made them superstars, I believe, him, Richie Sambora, and Desmond Child, the songs they wrote were unbelievable. He was smart enough to know that he needed Desmond Child.
Right.
And that he needed to co-write these songs with those two people. And when those songs started getting written, and then whatever producer they had, it might have been Bruce Fairburn or Bob Rock, one of those two guys, I forget. Right. He just got the best people to fill in all of the blanks. You know, he knew what he could do well, and he had the best people write his songs with him and the best producer produce.
Wow.
And that's what I think made him go from just being a gold. The first Bon Jovi record I remember went gold. But what made him a multi-platinum, biggest, you know, rock star in the world, biggest rock band in the world, was the writing team.
Right.
The production, but those three writers writing those songs.
Right. Wow. So tell me a little bit, like, when you were in the studio and you're recording this, do you remember, like, when you were recording the song, the actual song, the solo and all this other, you know, because everything about it, especially from a guitar player's perspective, everything about it was iconic, not just John singing and stuff, but the whole thing was, so, you know, when you and I hooked up and became friends, I'm just astonished at how humble you are, but yet you've been a part of some just incredible things. And so I'm excited to kind of hear the story of this whole thing.
Well, the thing is, I moved to LA at the end of 1979, and I jumped right in, and the industry was strong. So I was able to kind of jump into a very vibrant, robust industry. So I have it up here. Okay, so I discovered, I don't know if you discovered this too, you probably discovered it and moved on to a million other things, but I discovered if at fret 9, you do a harmonic, it sounds very wicked.
Yeah.
And that's all that is. It's like me going, you know, it's one of those discoveries. If you do it here, it sounds nice. If you do it here, it sounds nice. But if you do it here.
Yeah, there's like pitches going down, pitches going up.
Yeah,
there's
exactly.
All kinds of weird stuff.
All of a sudden you get skull and crossbones, right? Okay, so that's that. And then a lot of this was what I realized when I moved to LA in the 80s that like these days, eighth note parts happen up top. It's like you're going. But in those days, the eighth notes were all down here. And so that's all that is. I knew enough. I had my Schecter. Did I tell you that already? I had my Schecter with the gold. And so that was that. But when it came to the solo, I don't exactly remember, but I probably used my BC Rich Mockingbird or a Les Paul that they may have had sitting there at the studio, because you got to figure, I was in the power station. I had some of my gear there, but the amps were just Marshalls that had been brought in. That's what in those days, you just brought in all the Marshalls and you figured out which one sounded best. You might have six heads sitting there. So they brought in Marshalls that we used, not a lot else, you know, you just. So you can hear. Oh, so the solo has some elements to it, but there was also some of this.
Yeah.
You know, the Wang Bar stuff. But I remember in the solo, there was something that I was doing a lot of those days, which was this. And I would do it. I did it a little too much. And so you hear it in this solo. I can show you. It's like, stop.
That is so great.
So, yeah. So with that, this was just standing there in the studio with Tony Bon Jovi sitting there. I think the engineer was a guy named Lance Quinn, And then John sitting there too, calling, you know, John calling the shots. Because like I said, at 18, he was laser focused.
Right.
Laser focused.
So how many times did you, was there like multiple takes of the solo, or was it a, like, how did you come about that?
I don't remember.
Okay.
No, there was no rehearsing. I mean, I already knew the song because we had tracked it.
Right.
So what happened typically, you would do a tracking session and then almost always you would just keep the drums because you would mother, you know, you would get the other sounds better in the overdub stage. So they might just get the drums and bass in the tracking session, send all the other guys home because everybody's time and energy is expensive.
Right.
And then you would redo the guitars in the overdub mode. And that this was the case for that. So I would say what happens usually, I don't remember, but I probably got like a third of the solo. And then they said, go high. And I went, and then I went, yeah. And then I probably blew the ending. And then they punched in. And I went, whatever the ending lick is.
Right.
So it was probably two punches. It was probably done, you know,
right,
in three sections. Let's listen. Yeah, and something I still do these days, a lot of times I end a solo on a down note. And that's, I wish I ended more, you know, it's just a nice alternative rather than ending on the high note, because we all end on the high note a lot.
That's right,
know?
That's so, right.
Yeah.
That's right.
But, you know, the band was going to E, so, and you know. But if you listen to this solo, it's kind of exactly the way I sound today in some ways, too.
Right. That's just so...
It's like identical. Wow.
You have that. I have my cat is sitting over here. Watching. I'm just waiting for the cat to jump on my lap. So,
yeah, something in the closet just fell. So sorry. Anyway, but yeah, it was really fun.
Right. Okay. So when you were doing this, how many tracks do you think you did? Because there's the thing.
Yeah. Let me listen, and I'll tell you.
Okay,
so the
basic
thing.
One of my favorite parts right there, just that thing. I love that part.
So that would have been doubled, right? So that's the main part.
Right.
So you would do that, they would pan it all the way to one side, and then you would double it exactly, they'd pan it all the way to the other side. And then this next thing's an overdub. You know she lights the lights at night on the neon Broadway sign. This. But let's see. And that was my Schecter. So the other thing was probably the Les Paul style guitar. And then this overdub was definitely the Strat. You know, oh, it's the E. So it was the... So that's guitar number three. Let's listen.
I am absolutely geeking out.
So I'm thinking just two main guitars, this overdub guitar in the center, and then the solo. I may have only taken three tracks.
Wow.
Now remember, this was 24 track recording, so there was limited space.
Wow.
So what happens is there's the overdub Strat, there's the two basic heavy rhythms, and then probably on the overdub Strat track is where the solo appears. But I had another experience with John. Exactly 10 years later, I was at A&M, which is now Henson, which is one of the bigger studios in LA. It's an amazing place. There's four big fancy rooms there. And I was walking down the hall and John walked around the corner in the hallway and said, "Hey, Tim, I just finished a Christmas song. I need a solo." And I said, "Oh, okay, I'll do it." Because he had just had Don Felder from the Eagles play and they didn't get a solo. So it ended up being one of the best solos I've played on a record. It was it turned out really nicely. I'm going to go to it and find it here. It was Please Come Home for Christmas.
I'm familiar with this tune, yeah.
Yeah, and it's really it's good. It's really good. Bells will be ringing, the greatest show. So that's Don Felder from the Eagles playing the rhythm, and then it comes to the end, and that chance meeting with John in the hallway. It's actually one of my favorite solos that I've ever played on a record. It turned out really good. The tone is really good. And,
right?
Yeah. In the key of A. I know that now. Right. Yeah. It's exactly the kind of stuff I play all the time. I knew that was an altered chord, and so my way around it is just to kind of play the one and the flat five. You know, if you don't know something, sometimes you can just take two notes and make a lick out of it. That's what that is. And I'm kind of mixing minor and major, but if you get a chance on Spotify, that it's a nice, and they play it every Christmas. It's nice. You kind of, I'll be in like Home Depot or whatever, and it'll come on, and it's like, yeah, it's so cool. That's the thing about Christmas songs; they get played forever. So.
Right.
But that was exactly 10 years later, so it was kind of neat to meet him by chance in the hallway and do one more solo for Bon Jovi.
Wow.